Thank you very much, Madam President. So though 5th September is formally the Teachers' Day, for me today has been the Teachers' Day after addressing the AFAP rally, coming here and discussing this. And I would start with what I was saying there also, that though the landscape is very bleak, but the silver lining is due to the government of Narendra Modi, that he has brought all of us with such diverse backgrounds together. I was very, very pleased to see Mr. Jawaharlal Sinha, with whom I had so many clashes on the floor of the parliament. Since essentially today's discussion is about defending criticality, because I think heart of university education and higher education in general is criticality and the defense of criticality. Therefore, I think the audience will not mind if there is some criticality in the way views are articulated across the dais. I think that will only strengthen this movement, because we need to bring together a very diverse section of the people. If we think that all of us will parrot things, I think the kind of forces that we are faced with, we cannot take them on. And that is why it is very, very good that in the past there has not been such proximity in thinking and harmonization of the approach of the AIPACTO, which mainly consists of college and university teachers belonging to the state universities, and the FEDCUTA, which covers the central universities. Because as a student activist, we started, and this was one of the main issues, that in the policies of the UGC, there was a certain imbalance in the approach of the central government and the UGC towards the state governments. And I think this is another area of strength in the current struggle, because if we study the AGCI bill, one of the major things is, and I think this is for Professor Gowda also, because this is a very, very positive development, that the government has informally agreed to refer the bill to the standing committee, because the changes that are taking place all over. No, we hope that expectation will come true, but generally we had a major assault on the parliament, and one of the major areas of that assault was earlier there was an unwritten convention that all new fresh bills, major bills, were invariably referred to the parliamentary standing committees. Now we have completely departed from that tradition. And I think it is a loss for the parliament, and more so for the nation, because in the standing committee we had created a mechanism whereby we could have critical discourse, and more importantly, though parliamentary standing committee's recommendations are like, say, US House, it is not mandatory in nature, but as Professor Gowda has pointed out, that what happens, that I know people are here who are very critical of the quality of our parliament members, but there are 10 to 15% very good members cutting across political lines in the parliament, and they also play a very important role in the standing committees. So ultimately the kind of reports that we'll have from the standing committees are very good in nature. So though not in mandatory in nature, these recommendations have a certain weight to persuade the government in taking up certain amendments to the original bill which is proposed. But I don't know whether this will be ultimately, but I think one of the major pressure points should be that the government, because it showed a rare hurry in pushing across, pushing through this legislation. Only 10 days were given. When they put out in their official website that only 10 days will be available to give responses. But I think they did not anticipate the kind of dissenting voices that will get articulated, and maybe this also will get delayed, and maybe we can also together create this pressure to get the bill referred to the standing committee. I think that should be the first pressure point on the government. The second question is, I think that is also very good that when it was being introduced, it was said that JNU is very inclusive. But today, it is also very clear that being inclusive is not enough. You have to be non-insular. Because unless we become non-insular and really fraternize with all those sections with whom we might not have united in the past. I mean, really, it has to be the broadest possible unity and activism that can take on the challenge that we have. So, inclusive, yet non-insularity should be one of the major grounds on which we should proceed. I think it has already been mentioned that JNU has earned this distinction that to receive a PhD thesis, it has to come via the courtroom. And I'm sure this is not a very glorious distinction, but whatever it may be, it is at least good that some judicial pronouncements are there to defend some of the basic rights of the students and the researchers. What I think that structure, the main problem with the HECI bill is this, that you see not one single aspect. The three aspects of centralization, of commercialization and communalization. Separately speaking, some of these factors were there. Commercialization was there also. I mean, in the structures Professor Gowda was commending, in that also there were certain elements of commercialization. We'd be living in a fool's paradise if we talk of that other experiences of the West. Because here, the question is not mere private funding. The question is whether that funding will be on non-profit basis. In many of these Western countries, the private funding has also ensured that it is on a non-profit basis. That profit and non-profit basis of funding is the very important distinction. I don't think that we should forget about that change that is there. So today, the kind of push for commercialization that one is witnessing is happening at two levels. One is give encouragement to private sector, and to what extent that encouragement can go will just one simple example will suffice. Now we know heart of the funding exercise is evaluation. I mean, most of you have been teachers. You have gone from corridor to corridor, door to door to get funding for your center, for your projects and so on and so forth. But the basis of your proposals have been the requirement of funds and the evaluation of those requirements, objective. I mean, whether they are objective or not, that is a different question. But you have to premise it on the rationality of a requirement based on a certain process of evaluation. But that evaluation goes through the window in this HECI bill. And the mind of the government is most explicitly clear from this recent exercise of naming institutes and giving them the status of eminence. Now, can you think that an institute which does not have an address, which does not have a building, which does not have a teaching strength? I was just reading, Indian Express has come out with the details of what was contained as the proposal by the Geo Institute. It was entirely their money. That they, how much they can collect fees from students during annually, that was the basis. Therefore, and secondly, it also contains the idea that universities and institutes are completely deregulated. Deregulation and centralization, the point Professor Gowda was making, that it is absolutely dependent on the government. Government wishes, somebody will become eminent. Now, when they were under pressure, Prakash Javarekar came out with a statement that no, we are not giving that 1,000 crores, which is part of the package for eminent status of eminence. But the point is, they will go for market capitalization. Now, getting a status of eminence in the market, how will it play out? Because today everything is monetized, and therefore they will in fact earn much more than 1,000 crores. So the question is, the main point is centralization, and centralization, even Jagdish Kumar of JNU fame or infame, I don't know, even he cannot be included in the new HECI bill. I mean, that is the tragedy. There is very little scope of academicians to be in the Higher Education Commission. That is the greatest irony of this entire exercise. Forget about teachers. So this centralization and bureaucratization, this is one of the major problems. The other part is, of course, commercialization. Again, it will proceed along two lines. One is direct private and commercial institutions. Other is to convert from within the nature of public-funded institutions. I mean, public-funded institutions themselves will be forced to go for change in a manner, in the situation where they are starved of public investment, where you cannot distinguish between a private institution and a public-funded institution. And third element is that of communalization and all kinds of identity politics, not in the sense of imparting social justice, but killing that. What she was mentioning in the very beginning, that the advances that we have made so far, and this I say has not started after independence, but from the days of freedom struggle. I mean, there are several historians, I do not have the audacity of telling you about them, but this struggle of democracy, for democracy in the sphere of education, has advanced hand in hand with the struggle for social justice and sustaining diversity and representative character of our higher education. And the problem is that in the past we had aberrations, deviations, but never before such powerful coming together of all these three elements. That is, the, I think, the new element that has come about. And we knew that higher education was based on three principles of quantity, quality, and equity. So, in all these three spheres, who was introducing the general impact on higher education? I was seeing some data. All over the country, there's a large number of vacancies in colleges and universities that have come. You have a direct outcome of the starving of public funding that we have, and because we had an explosion of private institutions. It started in dribbles in 1995-96 when the first private university was allowed, and then it has come in torrents after 2005. So now there are more teachers in the private sector, there are more students in the private sector in the higher education, and therefore now, and because the sphere of unemployment also, we are having a simultaneous crisis. Therefore, those parents who were prepared to sell their land, sell their house to send children for private funded higher education, they cannot sell. So that has got also linked to banking crisis, because the money that was taken by private education entrepreneurs, they cannot return money. So it's a royal mess in this situation. Therefore, I think it is very important to link all these elements who suffer because of this overall thrust. And the bringing together of all these elements is absolutely necessary to really fight out and organize a successful resistance. But I am optimistic. I think already the science that teachers are expressing their criticality not only inside the classroom but also in the streets, and teachers, their basic work is to teach, but they are forced to come to the streets as activists. These signs are clearly discernible. So I think all of us, we can think of, so far as we are concerned as a party, CPIM, we have prepared a note. We don't think it is final, but we think it is a good material for the discourse that we have to carry on for this resistance to the bill. And I hope all of you will take it up, and we will, I'm sure, have more occasions like this to interact on the subject in the coming days. Thank you.